brought to you by Penguin.
What July Knew by Emily Koch. Read by Charlotte Worthing with Mark Meadows. Chapter 1. 20th of July, 1995. July Hooper was always hot because she was born in a heatwave. This rare ribbon of information was handed over by her grandma, who promptly realised she had pulled it loose from the forbidden fabric of conversation that was July's mother, and pinned her lips shut. Nobody ever talked about Maggie Hooper's life, or the awful way it had ended. But this rare ribbon could not be woven back into the secrets, rethreaded into the silences, or even fixed into place with an embroidery of deceits. So Yaya cut it free with a sharp change of conversation. "Time we opened the rich teas, don't you think?" And July slipped it into her pocket to twist around her fingertips. Many years later, July would wonder how else the day of her arrival had affected her. Was her habit of not telling the truth due to the fact that she was born into a world of lies? Did the violence around her birth destine her to commit an act of it herself? But she wasn't thinking these things today, because right now, she was only 10, and she didn't know about the lies, or the violence. Not yet. In fact, she wasn't 10 for another 2 hours and 12 minutes, but nobody had ever told her the exact moment of her arrival. It was one of the things on the big list of questions in her notebook, where her mother's identity was cleverly disguised with celebrities' names, in case her father ever flicked through. There were important topics on the list, like the time of day she was born, but also lower-level queries that occurred to her at a rate of about 2 a day. So, what time did Princess Di give birth to Prince William was sandwiched between, was Frank Bruno right or left-handed, and did Celine Dion prefer skirts or trousers? Right now, July Hooper was sitting on the shady edge of the playground, her notebook in her lap, as her long auburn waves were twisted into a tight coil by her best friend, Katie Faye. "Did Eric Cantona like mint choc chip ice cream?" July scribbled when Katie Faye stopped tugging at her hair to glance across the playground and refer to the backs of Sylvie Rose and Helen Knight's heads. Those two girls had identical buns at the napes of their necks, held in place with nets and bobby pins, and encircled with bright yellow scrunchies, which made them resemble a pair of sunflowers, though July wasn't sure any part of Helen Knight deserved comparison with something so friendly and cheering.
"How do they make them look so perfect?" Katie Faye asked. "They have good genes. Straight, silky hair."
July dropped her pen and winced as Katie Faye resumed yanking her own locks into submission.
"And Elnett."
She gagged a little at the thought of the hairspray's overpowering scent. Her stepmother loved it, which was one of many reasons to be suspicious of her.
"Can we stop now?" she asked. "My feet are in the sun."
Katie Faye released July's hair and made space for her to shuffle backwards. For the past few weeks, July had been racing out into the playground straight after lunch to secure their place next to the wall in a coveted strip of shade, which diminished as the afternoon bell drew nearer.
"This heat is deafening,"
Yaya had said last night on the phone when she called to wish July a happy birthday eve.
"Don't you think?"
July had nodded into the mouthpiece while her lips circled around a question. She had no idea what her grandmother meant, but that was not unusual. And whether or not it was deafening, this heat certainly was something.
Relentless. Exhausting. Suffocating.
It was the kind of heat that would cause blood to boil in the weeks that followed, the kind of heat that would convert irritation to rage and sadness to madness. But most of the other kids didn't seem to notice its weight pinning them down, especially not the likes of Year 5's self-designated queens, Sylvie and Helen, who grew more tanned and blonde with every day that carried them closer to the end of term.
Who were they playing now?
Katie Fay put her hand over her eyes as she squinted into the sun.
I can't see.
Sylvie and Helen were crouching on the other side of the playground, where a steady stream of other children had been taking them on at pogs.
You're kidding, July said, standing to get a better view. It's Darren Emerson.
Darren had stacked his collection of bottle-top-sized cardboard discs in front of Helen, who was preparing to attack his carefully arranged tower with her metal slammer.
Have you seen the way she throws it down?
Katie Fay imitated the motion with a flick of her wrist.
Maybe that's why she wins so many.
July lifted her baseball cap and wiped the sweat from her forehead.
Helen wins so many because she cheats. You realise you're only meant to keep the ones you flip over? That's not how she plays it. She takes an extra 3.
Exactly. Those aren't the rules.
But she has the special 3 slammer, so she can have...
Oh. Katie Fay stood up too.
She made that up. Why is he playing them again?
July asked. Last week, Helen had cheated Darren out of his entire collection.
He must have bought some more. What a wally. He'll be okay. Mr. Silk's keeping an eye on them.
July scanned the playground. Sure enough, there was the Year 4 teacher, who was known for doling out the harshest punishments in the whole school, twisting his bow tie as he leaned against the main door. He was closely following the unfolding Pogs battle. July looked from Mr. Silk to her classmates and back again. Sylvie and Helen were about to get into major trouble.
I can't let her do this.
She lifted the hem of her dress and tucked it into her knickers, exposing the backs of her pale and freckled thighs, embossed with the imprint of tarmac.
Here we go again,
Katie Fay said, leaning back against the warm bricks of the school building, as July stretched her arms above her head to limber up and twisted her pink baseball cap so that it was facing backwards. She stepped out from the shade and marched across the playground. July possessed 18 facts about her mother. They were all she had been able to glean in her 10 years, mostly from her grandpa Tony, because her father found it unbearably painful to talk about his late wife. These facts were a precious collection of ribbons, scraps of thread and shreds of cotton, the odd button and a sequin, each torn from the patchwork quilt of actions and wishes and feelings that, sewn together over a lifetime, had made up her mother. They fitted neatly onto one side of A5, the list of mum, which she kept folded and hidden in her pants drawer. Her father would never go in there. Number 7 was Maggie Hooper loved to dance. The passion was hereditary. As July made her way across the playground, she began to twist her hands above her head, lunged to one side, and launched into one of her painstakingly choreographed routines. At home, she rehearsed her moves to the accompaniment of the biggest chart hits of the moment, carefully recorded from the top 40 onto tape each Sunday afternoon. But that was in her bedroom, or the kitchen, if she needed more of a slide underfoot. It was different in the playground. Better. As she skipped from left to right, her schoolmates stopped what they were doing to watch. Girls held their hands over their mouths and pointed at July's exposed knickers, but she kept dancing, spinning round and round. One boy from Year 6 shouted, "Look at Ginger Nut go!" Still, she kept dancing, flicking her hips from side to side as she imagined strutting down a catwalk. And then Helen and Sylvie turned round. Helen started laughing, elbowing her best friend, but there was no smile on Sylvie's lips. Her skin flushed a deep red, Her eyebrows disappeared up under her blonde fringe, and her mouth hung open. July stopped a metre away from them and began voguing, staring Sylvie straight in the eye. As she framed her face with her hands to strike her fourth favourite pose, Sylvie jumped to her feet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.